expansion to the definition which has happened, which clearly goes and says, irrelevant of the impact on profit, loss, asset, liability, whatever, you please go ahead and report any transaction of a business restructuring, because it could have some future impact which the tax officer really wants to be aware of it at this point in time, if it's something which is that.
So, I think the broad view, and I will be taking a conservative view, is that whenever this business restructuring or business reorganization is happening, you think in your best judgment it will classify under these definitions, you can take guidance from all these, please report. Because the penalty for non-reporting is very steep, 2% of the value of international transaction of non-reporting, 2% for non-maintenance of documentation. And obviously, if you have not reported, you will not be able to give it during the TP audit. 6% is a cumulative penalty. I will be very skeptical and say that conservatively, please report. And do the groundwork. Do the homework well. You know, have your things to say that why no value should be attributed or whatever that is. But do your homework well and please report. So we talked about this issue. I'm not, so for two things, for want of time, and second is for in the next, Saturday, we have the session where I'm going to talk about the subscription of shares in detail. So I'm not touching it. All of you know it, what it is. So I'm just keeping it out. This is probably something which you all of you need to be aware of. So M&A, mergers and acquisitions. There are various types of restructuring which can happen through an M&A type of deal. It can be by way of a merger, it can be by way of a demerger, amalgamation, stock purchase, asset purchase, lump sale, buyback, capital reduction. So there are a whole host of things which you can do. What we are trying to do is to evaluate some of the TP implications of some of these transactions, not all, which could be critical. So I'm not getting into the definitions. You can see section 2.5 and 219AA for merger and amalgamation definitions.
But one question on conversion, what would be your view?
Conversion to an LLP?
Maybe to an LLP, maybe to a different entity. Because there is a Bombay High Court judgment, tax thing. The conversion, there is no transferor and transferring. I mean, only one can exist at any point of time.
Yeah, so that's why people have been trying to take that route. To my mind, it should not classify as restructuring, because we have the Bombay High Court judgment also on this. And since you are just converting a characterization of an entity, I don't think that should be allowed. Because again, it goes back to the question of whether there is a difference between tax planning and tax evasion. It goes into that level. And tax planning within the four corners of we have a section on GAR, I'll talk about it. But GAR, before GAR coming in, tax planning is still our permissible. So, go back to this section of, I've got this case study for all of you. See, what is happening in this case is there is a transfer of shares of an Indian company from one foreign company to another foreign company. What happens in this scenario? Obviously, the transaction is going to be taxable in India. So, then what? If it is taxable, then we have to have TP implication on this. But what comes to our rescue is if you go back to section 47.6b, it says if there is a merger of a foreign company with another foreign company, and because of that, and the conditions of the merger are such that, post-merger, about 25% of the shareholding remains unchanged, and it's a tax neutral in the country in which the merged entity is located, that's a transaction which is not treated as transfer. So accordingly, since it is not treated as a transfer, it is not taxable. Since it is not taxable, TP will not apply. This provision still holds good to my mind, irrespective of the business restructuring thing that you have done. But yes, probably you'll have to report this. Report this transaction in the Form 3CB, but you need to make a disclosure in your Form 3CB itself, even in your TP report, that because with the operations of Section 47 and Section 90 to become a machinery provision, TP will not apply to this transaction. Clear? Any doubts, any thoughts on this? same is the case with the demerger. If there is a demerger of one unit business B to another unit business B, same provisions, go back to section 47, 7C, it says that if there is a demerger of this kind which is happening and 3/4 of the shareholders or 70% of the shareholding remains same, then, and it's a tax neutral transaction, then TP will not apply. Or it is not treated as a transfer. Since it is not treated as transfer, TP will not apply. So, despite change in this definition of section 92, even I'm called repeating myself, these provisions will still hold true unless section 47 is changed. I can skip this. Buyback. All of you will know under the erstwhile provisions of Companies Act section 77AA and now it's section 68. It's buying back your own shares. So what is going to happen is the implications of this is that the shareholder will have to pay capital gains tax. With effect from Finance Act 2012, there is a provision which has been brought, 115QA, which says that even the company will have to pay withholding tax. And that's basically coming out from that ruling of AR in case of Otis, in case of Otis Limited. What was happening was, people were doing buyback as a provision to, pay out money without paying this DDD. And AR actually applied a judicial guard. Still, we don't have statutory guard, so they applied a judicial guard to say that transactions in this nature, which are transferring money out of India, with a way to escape tax or evade tax, will be liable to tax in India. Post that, Otis ruling, there is an amendment which has been made to say that if there is a buyback which is happening, this will be liable to a withholding or a DDT which has to be paid by the company at the rate of 20%. Whenever you are doing a buyback, TP will apply because the value at which you shares were subscribed and the value at which you are redeeming, that has to be at offset because there is going to be a capital gains impact on that. So you need to compute the fair value and do a disclosure. There is no escaping from this. Rajesh, you want to add anything on this? Okay. I just want to skip these a bit fast because I want to go to some of the examples that we have, or we can talk about this.
Kind of doing it from capital reduction.
Yeah, sure. Go ahead.
And just one key point on capital reduction, and that's where we are continuously harping on the discussion that no tax on no TP, is that if you really look at the theme on the merger example, the demerger example and all those, we are trying to convey the message clearly is that if any of these transactions are not taxable, there is no worry in terms of transfer pricing, except conservatively you may want to report that transaction. That's the only message that we are trying to say. In terms of capital reduction also, typically what happens is that in the hands of the company, the maximum implication would be that there would be a deemed dividend tax which will be there. Nothing beyond that. But when we are talking in the case of a shareholder, there would be a capital gain implication, and wherever a foreign shareholder is participant to such a capital reduction exercise, that is where a debate will occur. And all of us would be aware of various rulings which are there in this case because this is again a highly debated situation. We had a special bench in case of Mumbai Tribunal on Bennett and Coleman on this. We had few Supreme Court rulings on capital reduction. The theme again from the various Supreme Court rulings and the special bench ruling is coming up is that first you need to really check whether a capital reduction is really resulting into a transfer. And if that doesn't result into a transfer, if the SLC or the tax shareholder, the situation is similar to what it was pre-capital reduction, then is there really a transfer which has happened? If no, then that is where you come back to BCC Revenue Society and say that no capital gains, no taxable impact, no TP applies again. So now the theme, whatever it may be, continues the same. That's the point we want to make.
So in acquisitions, you skip the slide and you are saying that TP will not apply. Just very fast, can you say why it will not apply?
See, what we wanted to say is that if there is an Indian company which is interposed and you make it a domestic transaction, then TP will not apply. That's what we are trying to say. So there is a foreign company, there is an Indian company which is holding. You interpose another Indian company and you sell the shares from India to India. Since this transaction is happening from one Indian entity to another Indian entity, it's not cross-border, that's a TP point. That's what we wanted.
I think the example will explain this.
Yeah. We have an example, we have a case study. So I want to rush to the case studies where you know we'll be discussing some of these. Maybe you know some of these things. I just want to put two things. The issue of equity shares. Let's park that. I'm anyway covering it in the next week. So let's hold on to that. How do you benchmark it, etc. But preference shares, I wanted to just elaborate. Preference shares, when you are allotted, is there a TP implication or not? Because equity shares, all of us we have been contending, it's a capital receipt, not taxable, etc., etc. What happens to a preference shares? Any difference in that? Why TP will apply to or should not apply to a preference shares? Is there a difference between equity and preference shares? Any thoughts?
Preference shares is a liability. Maybe over a period of time you have to pay it back. So
equity is also a liability.
Equity is okay. In the Indian parlance, fine, you can buy back and make it somewhat similar to preference capital, but prima facie, if you cannot issue irredeemable preference shares. So that way, ultimately, it has to pay back over a period of time, whatever may be the tenure back.
Any other thoughts?
You can use pref shares as a thin cap, right?
Okay.
Equity share carries an ownership, whereas about preference shares, it is
okay. Okay. Any last comment?
And in the new companies act, it has been made at par to some extent, and probably you might be referring, like for the purpose of considering subsidiary companies, even paid up capital of preference capital also would be counted, which is not counted till March.
See, I'll tell you this is based on what I understand. There's a difference. Because when you're talking about preference dividend and preferential shares, there is a coupon rate which is upfront fixed, unlike equity. So what happens is, in an equity, you can distribute a dividend 20%, 30%. It's a unilateral act. It is not decided. You might decide not to give a dividend at all. That's a unilateral act of the company, of this Indian company, let's say I'm talking about India and US. But what happens in the preference shares, you decide the coupon rate of preference shares upfront. So it is more closer to a loan, and that's why you need to benchmark that coupon rate. So whether it's an inbound or an outbound preference shares, you need to benchmark that coupon rate upfront. How do you benchmark that? There are ways and methods. You need to find out what is the bond yield and add a premium to that. So there are statistical rules, let's not get into that. But bear in mind, whenever you are dealing with a preference shares, TP will apply upfront, unlike equity. And whenever you are doing a benchmark, these type of transactions typically deviate away from the traditional TP methods. Under a traditional TP method, you start with a FAR analysis, you come out with a characterization, etc. It's not required here. Because what you are doing is you are valuing that particular commodity or the preference shares, you are not valuing the company. Irrespective of what he is doing, it doesn't matter. So that's one thing in your mind which you need to keep in mind. And again, coming back, documentation has to be kept in place. You need to maintain the requisite documentation to justify whatever you are doing. Valuation, let's park this. I will discuss this in the subsequent session. Case studies or transfer pricing. This is what we wanted to really get at. Okay.
I think this is a scenario of a typical case where there are two foreign companies who are actually talking of a worldwide acquisition, and then there are Indian companies who are actually taking part into the natural course of action in terms of the group merging or demerging, because in terms of one of the activities here they want to demerge. So looking at a specific scenario here, if you really look at the situation, there is a situation where there is a demerger happening at the India level. If you can go to the diagram or the next slide. So here the demerger is happening at the India level, but because of a global acquisition, the group is now consolidating itself and there is a demerger which is happening. this demerger is probably will result into a tax-free demerger under the Indian regulation. So one will say that there is no role TP has to play in this. Two key aspects which one will have to look at from a TP perspective, and I will make a third point which probably we may want to think once, is that first, the TP policies between different companies will be different. Some ITS company, as in the example, is operating at cost plus 15, another is operating at cost plus 10. We need to align both the policies together, because though the groups have merged, that doesn't really mean the policies have equally got merged. So do we want to follow the policy of that merged entity which it is merging into, or we don't have a policy which has to be followed by the earlier erstwhile entity? Those are the issues which typically one will have to deal with. One of the other points which we really wanted to make in this is that if you try to look at the situation somewhere we are talking on the acquisition side of it, is that let's look at section 92B2, which talks of deemed international transactions. And in this case, the deal terms and conditions, if the terms and conditions of the deal were agreed by the overseas parent companies, and it was just that the execution piece was happening at the India level, probably there was a sense to say that this is an international transaction, and hence transfer pricing provisions will apply to this transaction, even if one has to leave aside for a moment to say that this is a demerger happening only at the India level. So let's look at a situation that there is no demerger happening. There is another transaction happening between two Indian entities. Because of a deal which is happening at the overseas level, it's typical 92B2 situation to say that if the terms and conditions are really governed by the overseas parties for the Indian entities, it will be taken as a deemed international transaction. Now that was a very debatable view, and there we had some clarity because of some tribunal rulings in the case of Kodak and Swarnandra, which referred to say that the intention of the section 92B2, because it is part of 92B1 and consequently to be read along with 92A, is that it's talking of an international case where there is a cross-border transaction and a third party is imposed to play around to say that TP will not apply. That is the real intention here, and not to catch hold of transactions between two domestic parties. But we would want to believe more in terms of the judicial interpretation on this point, is that are the terms and conditions of the contract really governed by the overseas party? If that is something which no one can prove, then there is no case to say that there is any deemed international transaction here.
So just like in case of Kodak, the tribunal has come to its conclusion that it's a deal between two domestic parties, and you know, valuation was done independently, etc. The tribunal specifically made a point that there is no material record to prove that the transaction between Kodak India and Carestream was a party to which transfer was happened, was influenced in any manner by Kodak US. So it was an independent transaction. So the word of advice that to all of you is that you know whenever there are such type of deals happening, just don't take notes of Kodak and Swarnandra and start saying that because this is a deal between two Indian parties, TP will not apply. Don't do that. Please look at who is the person who is driving these who is dictating the terms of this contract. Is it overseas or is it India? Please have that in mind, because this will have a larger TP implication otherwise.
Just wanted to leave another thought here to everyone. What would be the real implication under Section 188 of the New Companies Act? Because you know, we have always been talking of transfer pricing and international merger, demerger, or international restructuring. But today, when we are talking of Section 188, all the related party transactions, whether it are international or domestic, Section 188 wants to apply arm's length principle to all those transactions, where this is completely different as compared to what the domestic TP is, because domestic TP was on a few chosen sections, which was 48-2B and the tax holiday sections. But here, Companies Act has opened a complete big box to say all related party transactions will something which will fit. So any small merger, demerger, or any small restructuring within the group, probably you'd want to look at now at arm's length principle more closely in all those deals.
Because now it's Section 188 of the Companies Act, it's the personal liability of the director now. So, and there's an imprisonment clause also. So, be more careful on that.
Thank you. Can give this example and you make the point on that. I think that's more important.
So, okay, I'm just keeping this example, right? Maybe during lunch we can discuss it offline. GAAT. Sure, all of you know GAAT. Only rational, only this example is what I thought we will talk. Then why GAAT is being put in place? Why? Because what is happening is there are some unintended consequences which people have been trying to derive by making two or three, you know, mixing two or three provisions of the Act. And you know, so take this example. This example, holding company, let's say US company, was holding Indian company. What it did was demerged it into a Mauritius company. By operation of Section 47(7)(b), this demerger is exempt from tax. So this is a tax-free transaction. And then subsequently what Mauritius company is doing is that it is doing a buyback. Now since this buyback is being done and by a Mauritius entity, the gains are taxable in Mauritius. And as per India Mauritius, it is taxable in Mauritius, the capital gains is nil. So by adopting two provisions of the Income Tax Act, what taxpayer has done in this thing is that he has tried to evade the capital gains tax completely in India. These are the type of things which GAAT is trying to catch. So this is just a flag that I thought I will give you, because I'm sure you must be coming across these type of, you know, exotic structures which are being put by some of the taxpayers. Don't just get carried away, because these will have, you know, repercussions in the longer run. GAAT is going to be applicable from 1st April 2016. But if you are coming across any of these type of deals, please be aware, because we don't have a judicial GAAT now, we don't have a statutory GAAT now, we still have a judicial GAAT. That's the limited message that I wanted to give. And there are GAAT provisions which all of you know how to get into that.
This provision, this slide you have prepared, keeping in mind DDT, because earlier there was no DDT on
buyback. No. So this is, I've just tried to say that how you can use two provisions to do these type of things. And if you go back to the case of Otis, post which that DDT came into picture, it was something similar to this. So that's all from my side. We can talk over the lunch, but any questions, I'll be happy to take up. There is under 115 QA. There is.
As far as my understanding goes, we are not as such bound squarely by the OECD guidelines.
Yeah.
However, when it came to be guided about the definition of business or reorganization, we said it is the being TP professionals, Rajesh made a point that being TP professionals, we have to be predominantly guided by the OECD way of looking at it.
Correct.
So can you just clarify?
Sure. That's a good point. Let me just elaborate on this. We are not statutorily guided by OECD, because we are not a part of OECD, we are just an observer to OECD. But if you go back to the case clause of TP, see, because TP in India is still in its nascent stage. It's been just 11 years since you know that we have. But whenever there are, and if you read the TP provision section 92, it is just, you know, given there without any explanation. There are so many things which are just not, you know, brought out, like the definition of business restructuring. So where do you go? What is the recourse that you need to have? And the recourse is OECD. Because if you see many of the tribunal judgments, many of them now, they have heavily relied upon OECD. Now some of the tribunal judgments have also come back saying that we will rely upon OECD to the extent they are not contrary to the Indian TP law or Indian law. But fundamentally, if you see, OECD is taken or is accepted even by tax authorities, at least at the tribunal level, not at the TP level. TP they will do if it favors them. But at a tribunal level, OECD has been accepted. And that is where we are saying that if you read all these definitions, and that's why we have tried to bring out some three or four definitions. If you read all these definitions, that is where they are going, you know, giving a hint that whenever there is a cross-border redeployment of assets, functions, or risks, you know, that should be treated as a business restructure.
The point to add here is that if you look at the other definitions, there is no specific context in which those definitions are really made. Those are more broader and generic definitions. But if you look at the OECD, it's a specific thought brought out from a tax and a DP perspective on the same point which the law is wanting to be. And that's where we are saying that if this is a specific thought, then probably the specific definition intends to bring out the right aspect rather than a generic definition under any other aspect. That's the real point.
By the same logic, we can use section 482 regs and ATO's ruling.
So, a point very well made. USTP law or USTP regulations, the ATO definitions are being used. They are being used. If you go to the, whenever we are dealing with this corporate guarantees issue, we deal with, we take guidance from the ATO guidelines. They are probably the, one of the best ones. So, we do, tax authorities too do take cognizance of that. And tribunals, as I said, OECD is being heavily relied upon by them also. Because you don't have guidance, where do we go?
Sorry, just to add one more point here, is that if you really look at exit tax situation, which people would have spoken in the morning on that point, today Income Tax Act does not talk of any exit tax. Does that mean we never charge any exit tax? Does that mean the authorities don't really expect? Probably not. And that's where we'll have to look at the guidance which is available and the mechanism in which the world is looking at the.
So, if any restructuring is already getting covered in the other part of the TP provisions, where you are transferring some IPs, would you still cover it under the restructuring?
I will be careful and do that. I will be careful. For what a abundant caution, because see, anyway, you are reporting, sale of IP is being reported in one of the earlier process under intangible clause. But I'll still report it over here because it does not take anything for me to report. But if I don't report, there is a 2% penalty in the charge subject.
See, because there was also a discussion where there are transactions which get covered under ATIA 810 also and 48B also.
Yeah.
Is it that you report
that? So that stands on a bit of a different footing from this.
Once I say I have reported the transaction,
Just a point to made here is that when this reorganization is intended to report, it is not a single transaction of intangible transfer that one is talking of, or a small function transfer which issue of shares, assuming you are reporting somewhere else. It is a holistic transaction in itself is something which you are reporting, and that's where you really look at the reporting obligation in the form 3CB does not really want you to put across one transaction and one value. It says you report the business risk transaction, you report the terms based on which it is, you report the broad agreement that is entered into, and you just report that transaction based on which you believe that the method which it is asking. It does not really want you to go into each and every single transaction of them. That they assume would be reported individually in the form, but I would want to take a better view that those individual transactions would have any been reported. It's just that the holistic picture you are trying to bring, that the intention of all these multiple transactions is to enter into a business.
So, one last question, anyone? I know someone is waiting for you outside the lunch. Okay, that's it from our side. Thank you.
Your name is Restructure or
Reorganization? Sorry, the name is Structured originally. It's been, there is a story in that it's the first letters of my father, mother and my brother. But fortunately, it has a meaning also. It's from Rachna plus E.
Friends, coming to the pleasant task of proposing a very well-deserved